Paula, thank you for spending some time with us here.
It's wonderful to be here.
How are you enjoying your time here in New Mexico?
I'm having a great visit. It has been a very intense visit. We're trying to jam a lot of things into a short period of time. But I've had a chance to meet a lot of people in the community and spend time with the team here at KNME, which is a wonderful team. So it's been a great visit.
Wonderful. Speaking of intensity, we've just come through our congressional intensity, questioning the viability of PBS in our financial viability, so to speak. I have to imagine there were some lessons learned and some things that you had to search out to be able to present to Congress about who we are and namely who the audience is.
Right.
What did you find out on this journey?
Well, I think the biggest learning for me actually is that I think for many of us we make the assumption that people know who we are and what we do. We've been on television. Actually, KNME this year is celebrating its 53rd anniversary of its launch on the air. And I think that for at least from my perspective, I just assume that people recognize the work that we do and the lives that we touch. Going through this whole discussion on the Hill, it became very apparent that there's a misunderstanding about who uses public television. I think there's a misunderstanding that people assume that there's only a certain group of people that watch television. Some people talked about that we're just television for some East Coast elite. And I spend a lot of time crossing the country and talking to a lot of people who rely on public television each and every day. People for whom the work we do is so profoundly important for their children, for their families, and for their communities. And I just had made that assumption that everyone knew that. So what we have attempted to do over the last few months and will continue to do even coming out of this period is making sure that people that are making these kinds of decisions have the facts, that they understand that public television is used by a cross-section of people across the country, that we have a very large audience of very young children for whom public television is their preschool education, that we have a lot of people for whom public television represents not just nice time spent in front of a television, but is in fact experiences that are transforming their lives. And that, I think, is what, as we look forward, we'll attempt to give. There's one other thing that I would say to you, and that is, in this whole debate about federal funding for public broadcasting, there were some that said, look, we believe in public television, we just don't believe there should be any federal money in it. We want to help you become commercial. We want to help you have those resources. And I appreciate the offer to try to help us bring in more resources. We've never had adequate money to do all the things that we want to do, for sure. But in as I pointed out to those that made the suggestion, there are a lot of examples of commercial organizations who have tried to be the commercial version of public television. All you have to do is sort of look through the cable dial at channels such as Arts and Entertainment or Bravo or the History Channel or the Learning Channel, and recognize that most of the work that are on those channels has nothing to do with the kind of programming that public television produces. The Arts and Entertainment Channel has a lot of programs such as CSI. Bravo has programs like Top Chef. Even the History Channel, it focuses on programs such as Pawn Stars and Ice Road Truckers. Those are very different than the kind of work that we do in public television. And so I'm always looking for ways to bring in more resources, but that federal appropriation and our non-commercial charter, I think, is pretty profound in shaping the kind of work that we do, which is in fact tied to the needs of people in community, not necessarily in selling audiences to advertisers.
A kind of mission creep.
That mission
happens,
creep.
Sure.
And it happens, you know, look, a lot of these cable channels really started out with very different type of programming. But I think as every media organization is under a lot of pressure to bring in the kind of viewership and advertising dollars that are going to sustain them, it just pushes them in a very different direction. And so I think for us, we are looking for ways that clearly we're touching lots of people. We reach a lot of people across the country. 170 million Americans use public television and public radio in a single week. But I think that being able to create the kinds of programs that are not necessarily focused on men age 18 to 35, which is what a lot of commercial television pursues, but is programming that reaches very young citizens under the age of 5 and older citizens over the age of 50 and everyone in between is a little different.
Sure. Part of that search, so to speak, to tell our story involves the impact on children in the homes, in the homes and families that have young children in the home. What have you discovered there, and how has PBS been effective in that?
It's a really great question, and in fact, about 6 years ago, we began a process, I would say, a little bit of soul searching to really look at what we were doing with our children's schedule and to really think about what difference we could make in the lives of children. Now, we have a wonderful legacy in public broadcasting with people like Fred Rogers and going back to Sesame Street, which really transformed the way that people thought about television as a true educational tool for children. What we did is we looked at what was the need of children in this country, and we saw lots of children who never have the opportunity to experience pre-K education, going to school and being challenged, falling so far behind other children that had that educational experience. And so we decided that we would focus our programming dollars on programs that were not only entertaining, because if they're not entertaining, kids won't watch, but also had a curriculum basis. And we focused our early development on programs that were about literacy. And right now we're focused on some of the STEM subjects, you know, science, technology, engineering, and math for young children. And we have created a whole new schedule of programs, everything, and we built partnerships with some beloved children's character properties from literature, Curious George, Cat in the Hat, and worked with some people that we've worked with for many years, the Henson Company. We worked on two programs with them, Sid the Science Kid and Dinosaur Train. And out of that work, we now have a broadcast schedule that has a really rich curriculum embedded in it. And then we began to think about how we could create programming also for online so that children could not only watch video, but they could also play games at the same time. And in doing that, learn. And so we've built a whole schedule, and we've just completed some research that shows that not only are lots of children watching and enjoying the programs, but their language skills are improving at an average of 30% by watching the programs, and their math skills are improving significantly. And so we're going to continue to refine and work on that programming strand to try to really help the kids that I think need it most, kids that really need to be able to walk into the door of the classroom and be excited about learning and be ready to learn.
Your point on pre-K is very appropriate to this state. A lot of kids don't have that opportunity.
46% of the children in the state don't have an opportunity to attend preschool. Mm-hmm. And as we look at how particularly to serve those children, we know that there is a television in almost every home. And so the opportunity to bring true educational programming into those children's lives makes this a particularly compelling focus for us in public television. Mm-hmm. And then what our stations are doing and what KNME has been a real leader is in then thinking about how do we bring those programs into the communities through workshops and other kinds of outreach activities, working with also with daycare providers, but also non-traditional daycare providers, you know, people that have, you know, a few children in the home that they're watching during the day, and giving those daycare providers the kinds of resources that will help them work with the children and give them opportunity.
It's funny, you remind me, when my kids were young, we were looking for daycare. I swear to you, it's the truth, the woman we ended up using, what was sold was she had PBS on when we walked into her home to take a visit. It's very interesting. News and public affairs. Mm-hmm. There's been some interesting changes in PBS world. Nova's made some changes where all the science programming is very big here for us at KNME. Yeah. As you can imagine, all the scientists we have here in New Mexico. But news and public affairs, once again, mission creep, no mission creep, meaning, you know, we are a trusted entity when the public comes to view what who is disseminating news. From your position as CEO and president, what's your take on where public affairs and news is headed for PBS?
Well, you know, this is, as we think about the opportunities in this multimedia world that we now try to navigate through, there is, I think, great opportunity for news and information. Now, in public television, I think our greatest strength has always been not in breaking news. People don't come to us to find out, you know, what just happened around the corner. What they do come to us in hopes of understanding are the complexities of the issues of the day. And so what the NewsHour has attempted to do through its entire history is really look at the important news of the day, both national and international news, and to try to put it into context. And then I would say Frontline, as our really the anchor of our work in investigative journalism, has tried to really look at those critical issues over a period of time and also put those into context, and also with a significant focus both on national issues as well as international issues. What really, I think, has changed for us is the opportunity that online presents to be able to expand that reporting on a more immediate basis, but also to create an archive for not only the broadcast projects themselves. So Frontline is a great example of this. You can watch most of the library of Frontline online right now. You just go onto knme.org, go to the video player, punch up Frontline, you can pull down video. But what you can also do is, and looking through the Frontline site, is you can go back and look at some of the background research. You can look at the longer interviews. On some projects, you can look, because Frontline has covered the buildup to the Iraq War, you can go back and look at interviews over a series of documentaries and look at how various key players in this evolving story have talked about it throughout the course of the last few years. I think it's just a really rich resource. And so that's what we're trying to really explore the possibilities. Now, in the NewsHour of the last year, their online editorial team and their broadcast editorial team were completely separate. And so through the work of a number of key people and through the great journalism of Hari Srivanasan, we have been able to really bring those pieces together and also really expand into social media. And so Hari, as well as I think most of the journalists on the NewsHour, are also not only contributing to the online, but Hari is tweeting regularly. He's really looking for different ways to bring resources to the fore so that people are finding the content and also finding the content that they're hoping will help them really make sense of the world around them.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes in these things, devices become a critical part of that access to what you're talking about. And the price point needs to come down so more people can have access. Is that part of your planning, your long-term planning, long-range planning, is when those prices for those devices get to a low enough price point, disseminated widely enough, is it a whole new universe for PBS at that point?
Well, I think a couple of things. One is I do believe that the tablet is going to be tremendously important. And I think that obviously you're starting to see the price of those come down. And so the work that we did in developing our iPad application was really the first foray into really thinking about how you bring video onto the tablet form. I think the second part of that is we've spent time over the last couple years really thinking about the smartphone as a place to develop content and applications for the smartphone. And we did that not just because it was a cool new device, but because we recognize, or we believe, that for many people and for many families, their smartphone will be their computing device. It is at a price point that people can afford. It has other functionalities. And so I think that our early work on the smartphone, as a matter of fact, was with kids' content. And again, not because we thought that we would build this application so that children would buy smartphones, but we recognized that parents, in trying to create learning opportunities for their children, might appreciate having that kind of resource onto their phone. And the example that I always give is that moment that makes every parent's hair stand on edge when you're trying to get through the grocery store and the child is trying to pull things off the shelf. You know, the idea of being able to pull the smartphone out, to click into an application, and to hand the phone to the child and let the child not only play, but have a learning moment at the same time feels to me like a really good use of technology. And so we're experimenting a lot in this space, and we're looking for opportunities to share material there that we think will reach a lot of people.
Interesting. The arts, got to talk about the arts. It's a big part of our makeup here, as you know. Mm-hmm. And the commitment from PBS to the arts is unassailable. I mean, we do things that nobody else can do. But there's always more to do.
There is always more to do. Yeah. And as we think about, you know, we don't have the resources to do everything. And so we do have to be selective of where we invest our program money. And one of the areas that I have been concerned about for a number of years as I look at the range of programming on commercial television on cable is what's happened to the arts. And I grew up at a time, so now I'm dating myself, but I grew up at a time when, you know, there was a lot of arts content on television, even the old Ed Sullivan show, where you had, you know, you had the opera singer, you had the ballet singer, you had the Beatles. You know, it was just, there was a lot of opportunity to experience all kinds of music and performance. That doesn't exist anymore. And so over the years, public television has done a fair amount in the arts, but I think we can do more and I think we can do better. Mm-hmm. And so what we're hoping to do over the course of the next years, beginning this fall, is to really expand the amount of arts programming on public television and really to create a space so that people will have a regular place to go on a weekly basis to experience the range of arts. And what I'm talking about when I talk about the arts is everything from more contemporary music to classical music to jazz to theater, to dance, to visual arts, to poetry. I mean, I think it's a pretty wide spectrum, which makes it complicated. How do you sort of fit all that into a schedule and have it make sense? But I think that there is a way to do it, and I think that being able to explore those opportunities and really mine the rich artistic work that's happening all across the country. One of the reasons I was interested in coming to New Mexico, besides the fact that this is a great station here, KNME, that has been a pioneer for public broadcasting throughout its history, was also because I recognized the rich artistic tradition in this community. And being able to look at some of the work that's happening here and begin to think about how we might create some opportunities to bring some of the work that's happening here in New Mexico to a national audience, to me, is quite interesting. So I think over the course of the next few years, I'd like to look at ways that we can start to bring some of that work to a national audience.
Mm-hmm. You're now 5 years on in the job. There's got to be mornings you say to yourself, what have I done here?
Yeah, I have had a few of those. Particularly in the last year, I've had quite a few of those.
I can imagine. the rapidity of the change going on right now. Yeah. From, again, your position of president and CEO of this organization, how do you keep a handle on what's not only taking care of the business of the moment, but taking care of the business of a decade from now or a generation from now?
But that's what makes it so interesting, actually. Yeah. You know, there the challenges that we have, for the most part, that are the frustrating ones are the ones about money, because really trying to figure out where we're going to get the resources to do the work that we need to do. Most of the money that comes to public broadcasting comes from viewers like you. And so we're constantly looking for ways to, how do we communicate that value to people in communities so that they understand that supporting public broadcasting really comes back to them many fold over in the work that we're able to do. For me, the interesting aspect of what we're doing is the work that we're trying to carve out in this very rapidly changing media environment. And to me, that's exciting because, you know, in our history, we could create television programs that were important and they would be beamed into people's homes and then they'd sort of go out into the stratosphere. But the technology now offers us the true chance to connect content to people when they want it and how they want it. And that to me is really interesting. It also gives us an opportunity to create content that's that is of different size, of different space. Frankly, it gives us an opportunity to create content that people could interact with and then build on their own. You know, I think the ideas are limitless moving forward. And to me, that's interesting. And for public media, it's particularly interesting because if I'm sitting in the seat as a CEO of a commercial media company, my first concern is always going to have to be, and how can I make money doing that? In public television, my first concern is going to be, how can we take this technology and really do something that's important and impactful and transformational? That takes you down a very different path, and I think it's freeing, and I think it spawns a lot of creativity. Most people don't know that public television created closed captioning. Public television was the first media organization to do national satellite broadcast. Public television was the first media organization to really embrace high definition and begin to explore its potential. Public television was the first organization to really look at multicast on television and figure out how you could serve very different communities in a community from a single broadcast station. And so we've always tried to think about technology. In fact, I think some of the most creative people that work in public television are the people that are engineers and the technologists. And so being able to now think about this new technology, think about technology like mobile television, think about some of these new devices and figure out how can we use them not just to entertain people, but how can we use those technologies to connect people together and to inspire and educate. That to me is really great work. Mm-hmm. And so that's what actually keeps me zinging into work every day, even on those moments when I think, oh, this is hard.
I bet. Got to ask you though also about Spanish language television. Mm-hmm. VMA, changing demographics in our country. Clearly PBS has been on the front edge of this. Any clues to what we could expect to see for Spanish language viewers coming
up? Well, VMA has been an important service for us to be able to, and our stations, I should say, to be able to serve the increasing number of Spanish language speakers in this country. We've also been looking at the work that we're doing online to create a space in both English and Spanish. A lot of the work that we're thinking about right now for Spanish language is also in helping parents for whom English may not be a first language, working with their children. And so we hear from a lot of Spanish-speaking parents that they want to create opportunities for their kids to learn English, but their language skills are not quite so strong. So even in the development of some of our kids' programs online, we just created a service for very young children called PBS Kids Island. Information for parents is done in both English and Spanish. So even for parents for whom English is a challenge, they can go online and use the services in Spanish and help their children learn English. Mm-hmm. So I think we're really looking for a lot of opportunities to build out more and more content. We're also looking at ways to tell America's story through the great diversity of this country. And part of that is the culture, the Latino culture of this country. And so we're looking at building programs not just for Spanish-speaking audiences, but also programs for English-speaking audiences to really broaden the understanding of the richness of the diversity of this country. And so we're working right now on a multi-part series on the Latino experience in the United States. We did a great series last year, Latin Music USA, which was about music, but it was really also about the history of this country.
That's wonderful.
So we're looking to do more of that kind of programming moving forward.
That's gonna be wonderful. Paula, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, it's been great talking to you
today. Come back and see us.
I will.
Absolutely.